New York City, when the Me Generation adopted the hustle of the streets and a new sound was erupting from the underground. 1973, shaping the culture.
When you have like Chris and Tina, David Byrne from the Talking Heads, all four of the Ramones, you know, the Heartbreakers, Richard Hell, Television, Patti Smith, Debbie Harry, all in the same room, it's going to be fun, let me tell you. And it was. It was the best time ever.
The period of the 70s is a period of collision between the aspirations of youth culture and the fact that we can't trust any of these old institutions and we'll just, like, you know, keep it over here and in our funky little corner.
I was in a lot of punk bands, and we didn't call ourselves punk rock. We were punk bands. Then punk rock came along later. There were bands like The Slits. The Ramones were just starting.
Everyone thinks of CBGBs as, oh, I wanted to go there. No, you didn't. This was like the worst neighborhood, you know, in New York.
Surrounding CBGBs was the Bowery. It was the most notorious down and out neighborhood in New York.
On the Bowery, the Bowery.
It was a scary place to hang out.
The Bowery, I'll never go there anymore.
But a very savvy place to open up a club where you could afford to just be super creative.
For $1.50, you could get a quart of beer and a pack of cigarettes. And boy, you were doing okay.
CBGB's, strangely enough, stands for Country, Bluegrass, and Blues.
And other music for undernourished gourmandizers. No one ever knew what the U and Omfug stood for, because it changed every week. It was some weird hilly thing.
Hilly Kristal was a burly Jewish guy. He really respected creativity. He would not allow cover bands to play CBGBs. You had to come in with something original that you had created and make your own statement.
It reeked of urine. You know, it was grimy as hell. But that little stage in the back, you know, I mean, when they started having music, that's when it started happening.
Seeing the Dictators, the Ramones, the Dead Boys, I mean, it was just fantastic.
Suddenly, rock and roll wasn't something that just happened in arenas on huge stages by people who were semi-godlike. I mean, you had to pass by the dressing room at CBGB's to get to the bathroom.
The heart of what punk is to do what you want to do and to do that with 100% of what you're trying to do.
When the Ramones walked out in those black leather jackets and those sneakers, I mean, that was shocking. I mean, they looked like the SS. And they were singing, I'm a Nazi, baby, I'm a Nazi, yes I am. And you didn't know if they were kidding or not.
Blondie came up through CBGBs, and Debbie Harry certainly had a trail of groupies of both genders.
God, Debbie Harry up there in her fishnets. You'd look around and look at the guys, like, staring at her and think, oh my God, that guy's gonna rush the stage and attack her.
It seemed one of just great energy. It was like a focal point. I mean, it's an excitement that I would love to have been a part of.
It was not a great venue for absorbing music. If you didn't have the right spot, you just heard the music bouncing off the wall.
The punk scene might have happened without CBGBs, but probably not with the same speed and the same focus.
The drug culture of the 60s, there was something communitarian about it. By 73, it was about, you know, let's get stoned, let's get ripped, let's get twisted.